疫情震动全球高等教育，后新冠学年赴美留学生会否持续减少？
I feel sorry for all of our Chinese students who have this feeling that, you know, that Americans view them as part of the problem. So certainly I, and I know most leaders in higher education, will do everything we can to explain the benefits.
新冠疫苗竞赛白热化，谁会从中获益？
That's what the whole globalization era has been all about. It didn't matter where an innovation happened, as long as it could be spread to the world, everybody benefited. But I think we are seeing in the coronavirus and the search for a vaccine, we're seeing, in essence, a sort of nationalism.
风云对话专访美国沃顿商学院院长杰弗里·盖瑞特。3月29日，为控制境外疫情输入。中国民航局开始收紧国际航班总量，实施5+1政策，要求一家航空公司一个国家保留一条航线，一周一航班。5+1政策之下，国际客运航班量锐减90%。与此同时，2020年两会期间，全国政协委员、上海交委副主任的一声谏言，也被推上了舆论的风口浪尖。他建议因疫情归国留学生可入学高职高专，一时间中国留学生的归国问题牵动着许多国人的心。自改革开放以来，随着国家的发展和政策的完善，出国留学群体不断壮大。目前中国已经成为全球第一大国际生源国，中国留学生也成为了中国教育对外开放和中国人才国际流动的代表。然而，当新冠疫情冲击全球，国际化教育进程走到了关键的十字路口，国际教育的黄金时代会因此落幕吗？正当人们对疫情影响下的国际教育议论纷纷时，我们请来了世界顶级商学院——美国宾夕法尼亚大学沃顿商学院院长杰弗里·盖瑞特做客《风云对话》线上采访。盖瑞特出生于澳大利亚，是名杰出的国际政治经济学家。作为享誉全球的商学院院长，盖瑞特会从哪些方面分析这场大流行对人类造成的影响呢？
Hi, Geoffrey. Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
You see, now a lot of people say that this ongoing pandemic is going to change us, change the whole world for good. So if you are to name 3 biggest changes that would be inflicted by this pandemic, what would you say they are?
Yeah, I think from where I stand, the 3 biggest things are that kind of technology revolution that we were already experiencing is just going to get faster. We're seeing that already in the crisis. You know, the technology platforms, communication platforms are so much more important. Think in China about a company like food delivery. So technology would be the first thing I'd say. And that's just an acceleration of an existing trend. But I think we're going to see 2 changes in direction that are very important. The first one is probably what I would call deglobalization. In the past 10 years, certainly in the West, there have been a lot of concerns about globalization, but I would call that anti-globalization sentiment. I worry now that we're actually going to get in a deglobalizing era. Things will get unwound. International economic exchange will be reduced.
Sorry, very quick question. What's the difference between deglobalization and anti-globalization?
Yeah, so I'm thinking about anti just meaning sentiment. There were a lot of people who were concerned about globalization, concerned about the dislocations. But I think that sentiment is going to get translated into a reality. You know, in terms of US-China, for example, we will see more decoupling between the 2 countries. But the third trend, you know, is one that obviously matters enormously in China, as it does all around the world. And I would call this de-urbanization. You know, if you think about what makes cities distinctive, cities are all about crowds. And the problem today is that crowds have gone from being things that were energetic and gave us innovation
but
to something
for good
that
or for
now is viewed
bad?
As a risk.
The deurbanization.
I think it's bad. I think it's bad for at least 2 reasons. The first one is cultural. You know, I just think cities are very interesting places. They're very dynamic. But it's also bad economically. You know, China is a clear example of this, that It's been the movement of people from rural areas into urban areas, which has really fueled a lot of growth in developing countries. So if urban areas now become less attractive, I think that's bound to slow down growth.
Right, then how about in the environmental aspects?
We tend to think that cities are dirtier because of pollution, but actually cities are potentially much more efficient and much better for the environment than rural areas. I mean, just think about dense urban transportation networks. It's much better to have people on subways than it is driving their cars, and that's what cities make possible. But right now, no one wants to be on a public transport system because of the health risks.
Mm-hmm. You're right, definitely. So I know that you're in contact with numerous business elites, so in all different areas. And I wonder, based on what you gather, what would be the approximate timeline regarding when we will be able to have the cure therapy and vaccine?
Obviously, we don't know about that, but most people are thinking that by the end of this year, there would be so-called therapeutics. There would be drugs that would help mitigate the symptoms of the virus, but that a vaccine will probably be in 2021. And I think that's why a lot of economic predictions now have moved from a V-shaped recovery to what's being called a swoosh recovery. The recovery is bound to be a bit slower just because of people's health and safety concerns.
I remember that we have talked about technology and innovation before, and one of your often quoted view has been, it doesn't matter who wins in innovation because the whole world will benefit from more innovation no matter where it comes from. So do you think this theory also applies to the ongoing medical research for the COVID-19 vaccine?
Yeah, I absolutely think that. I mean, that's what the whole globalization era has been all about. It didn't matter where an innovation happened. As long as it could be spread to the world, everybody benefited. But I think we are seeing in the coronavirus and the search for a vaccine, we're seeing in essence a sort of nationalism where the whole crisis is being fought at the national level, not the international level. And I think that's a big difference from 2008, 2009, where there was a lot of international collaboration. So I think we're going to see a more nationally oriented response. And so there'd be a lot of pride, there'd be a lot of profits in developing a vaccine. But again, I would just hope that the second the vaccine is developed, it can be spread to the whole world because the world needs it.
What kind of implications that you see this pandemic is to have for the nationalism sentiments that you just mentioned?
Yeah, unfortunately, I think sort of inward-looking sentiment is understandable but unfortunate in the current environment. Everyone is thinking that they just need to be closer to home in so many senses. So that's understandable. The thing that would be quite unfortunate and regrettable is if that translated into big policy changes. So we haven't seen some of those already with kind of the closing of national borders. You know, again, I'm a global person, so I hope borders reopen. But you can see now that that notions like resilience and national self-reliance are just going to become much stronger because people can feel them because of the anxieties that the virus is creating. And it just says, let's get everything closer. That's the way people are feeling right now.
But some people tend to believe that the country that comes up with the vaccine first is going to win huge respect, this trust from other countries. And this may lead to different geopolitical scenarios in the near future. Do you believe so as well?
I can see that the kind of race for the cure and who gets to the finish line first it'll be kind of a validation of a country's innovation capability and the quality of their science and healthcare medical research. But again, I hope that would be just like a sort of Nobel Prize winning achievement, not something that would change the world geopolitically.
新冠疫情的持续蔓延，无疑使得本就复杂而紧张的中美贸易关系再添变数。5月8日，中美高级别官员通话，同意双方应努力为中美第一阶段经贸协议的落实创造有利氛围和条件。 推动取得积极成效。但同一天，特朗普接受美国媒体采访时威胁，如果中国未能兑现其购买承诺，他将终止贸易协议。一周后，特朗普甚至在一次采访中假设性出言，可能切断与中国的所有关系，并简单粗暴地以贸易算术给出了一个损失额。
Many things we could do things, we could cut off the whole relationship. Now, if you did, what would happen? You'd save $500 billion.
在疫情的大背景下，全球两个最大经济体的贸易战将如何发展？盖瑞特在2019年3月做客《风云对话》时，曾就中美贸易战发表了他的见解。他坚持用贸易摩擦来形容中美之间的贸易关系。在他看来，中美贸易战的本质是创新争夺战。时隔一年，盖瑞特的观点发生改变了吗？
You used to believe that the trade negotiations between China and America was not a trade war, but trade skirmishes. Do you still maintain the same argument today?
Yeah, I've always thought that the pure trade aspects of the frictions between US and China were actually relatively small and easy to manage. And I still think that's true. We could talk about the phase one deal, because I think it's going to be impossible for China to meet its phase one commitments in terms of the $200 billion in additional imports from the United States. But I still think that the bigger issues between the US and China are about technology rather than trade. And the reason technology is so important, and now maybe we'd include health technology in that, is that technology has not only big economic impact, but potentially national security implications as well. So that's why I've always thought technology rather than trade is the biggest challenge.
Back to my question, having seen what was going on between China and America regarding trade, you still don't believe that it is a trade war as people call it?
Yeah, it's very big politically, because the public can understand trade. You know, I think the way that certainly in the US this is viewed, and it's the way President Donald Trump has framed it, is that exports are good and imports are bad. So if you run a trade deficit, you're losing, right? That's the narrative of trade in politics in the United States. And so that's why Donald Trump has been able to say that the US has been losing to China. One thing that happened last year in 2019 that's bound to be accelerated in 2020 is that the trade gap between the US and China actually will go down a lot, because there just won't be as much demand in the United States for Chinese products, right? So that's a good news story, that the trade will become more balanced. But unfortunately, the phase one trade deal doesn't talk about the trade balance. It talks about Chinese purchases of American products. And I just think it's going to be impossible for China to increase its purchases of American products by $200 billion by the end of 2021, the way the phase one trade deal envisaged it.
I don't know if you have noticed that President Trump said that if China fails to keep this promise, and he's going to terminate the deal. So what does this mean?
Yeah, here the timing is really weird, but maybe beneficial, right? So President Trump is thinking about his re-election in November of this year of 2020, and he wants to be able to say, I delivered a tough deal, I won against China. But the phase one trade deal, the deadline, as you know, is December 2021, not November 2020. Mm. So Trump is bound to go into the election being tough with China, playing this China blame game that we're seeing on the coronavirus. I think we'll subsequently see with respect to trade. The deal isn't supposed to be finished until 2021. So in an optimistic scenario, but I think one that's realistic, by the time we get to 2021, it'll be possible for both sides to renegotiate the trade deal, because when the trade deal was struck, no one was anticipating the deepest global recession since the Great Depression, or 90 years ago. So just understandably, the conditions that people were expecting to obtain so that the trade deal could be executed, those conditions are gone. And you would think that the political leadership on both sides would renegotiate the deal in 2021, because it makes no sense in the economic conditions we're now encountering.
Right. So you're saying that it's quite possible that until next year, that two country leaders or the delegates, they're going to renegotiate the terms, but not until then. And this year that Trump is just going to maintain all the requirements based on the phase one deal and maybe even more.
So let's talk about maybe even more in a second. But the first part I agree with, that the president is bound to continue his I'm tough with China and I won against China. That's very helpful to him politically. And of course, it's more important now because he needs to say that it's not my fault that the U.S. economy has crashed. It's the fault of the virus and it's the fault of China. That's the kind of narrative that he wants to run. Now, if you think about his opponent, his likely opponent, Joe Biden from the Democrats, Biden as a political matter won't say you're wrong about China or it wasn't China's fault. What Biden will try to do is just be quiet on China rather than to try to contradict the president. So that's why I think the current narrative in American politics will continue through the election, but 2021 could be a very, very different political environment.
How about the scenario of America relate the debts to China?
You know, that doesn't make a lot of sense, right? I mean, it's actually incredibly helpful. It has been incredibly helpful to the United States for China to hold American debt. It has helped lower American interest rates. There's no doubt about that. So from an American standpoint, having Chinese ownership of treasury bills is a good thing. From the Chinese side, because so much of Chinese debt itself or Chinese contracts are denominated in dollars, it makes sense for China to maintain its purchases of U.S. treasuries. So from an economic standpoint, that debt relationship between the two countries makes perfect sense and is very stable. Certainly, there are political incentives to talk about it, but I think at the end of the day, cool heads will prevail. There won't be a call for, in some sense, for China to take back its debt. The issue that some people are talking about now is that America might increase its tariffs on Chinese products, which again would make no sense right now because it would raise the prices that American consumers would pay for Chinese products. But you can see that that's part of the trade narrative that Donald Trump has developed, this narrative over now an 18-month period.
So you just say that you acknowledge there's going to be huge difficulty for China to maintain its trade obligations to America based on what they agreed. Do you think it's a good idea that, well, the Chinese side initiates this kind of sort of renegotiation?
I think there's got to be a chance that the Chinese government will unilaterally lower some of its tariffs on American products because that would be good for the Chinese economy. I'm not as familiar with the political dynamics in China as I am in the US. So economically, it would make sense for both sides now to lower tariffs further because they need to support the economy as we enter a global recession, and lowering tariffs would help with that. Politically, I don't think that's possible in the US. As I said, I think Trump might threaten to raise tariffs. But in China, you know, certainly the world economy would welcome a lowering of Chinese tariff barriers at the moment, and that would be good for the Chinese economy. So I certainly would cheer that if it happens.
5月29日，特朗普签发总统令，以国家安全为由大规模取消中国留学生和专家学者赴美签证。这也是特朗普政府首次公然阻挠中国特定类别留学签证持有者入美。
Today I will issue a proclamation to better secure our nation's vital university research and to suspend the entry of certain foreign nationals from China who we have identified as potential security risks.
中国学生作为赴美留学的主力军，已连续十年位居美国海外留学生第一大来源国地位。但在2018-19学年度，中国赴美留学生增长率已明显放缓，创十年最低。这与中美两国近年来在贸易、知识产权、国家安全等领域不断升级的摩擦而导致急转直下的中美关系有密切关联。作为世界顶级商学院的院长，盖瑞特对当下的国际教育形势有什么看法呢？ 他又会对国际学生们说些什么呢？
Talk about the area in education. I guess we've already seen the decline to a certain extent in terms of the Chinese students being recruited by American universities. Do you think this trend is going to continue in the long run?
In the short term, it's bound to happen just because there are travel restrictions and processing of visas and things like that has become much more complicated.
Would you
and
call
much more
that、
delayed.
It's already the beginning of the decoupling?
I hope not. I certainly hope not, because I think that the globalization of higher education has been an absolute win-win. In fact, a win-win-win. It's been good for the US, it's been good for Chinese students, and I think it's been good for political understanding, sharing understanding between the two countries. It is going to be more of a challenge going forward, because international students now will be viewed as potentially not only carriers of the virus, but if we think that there's an innovation competition, Chinese students now potentially have an adverse impact on American security because they acquire know-how that they could then use in China. That's a political narrative that is in the US right now. I think it's a very regrettable one, and I feel sorry for all of our Chinese students who have this feeling that, that Americans view them as part of the problem. So certainly I, and I know most leaders in higher education, will do everything we can to explain the benefits, including the benefits to the United States, of having fantastic, talented, motivated Chinese students in our universities. But it's going to become more difficult.
Wow. Why do you say that it's going to become more difficult? Have you already felt this difficulty in reality, or this is just what you think logically is going to happen?
More logically, because I do think that right now, the virus response just makes it very hard for international students because of travel restrictions and because of visa difficulties, right? Mm-hmm. And that's understandable. We have to deal with that. Mm-hmm. My concern would be if that then becomes a mindset that higher education should become more national, right? Again, like supply chain, shorten supply chain, turn higher education from a global industry to a national industry. I think that would be very regrettable, but there's a chance that will happen now. So certainly I think it is the role of leaders in higher education to explain the benefits to everybody of having a global higher education system.
So you're a dean of the world-class business school in the world. Now I'm going to ask some advice from you on behalf of our viewers. So, first of all, what would be your advice for the small and medium businesses trying to survive or go through this period of time?
Yeah, it's for small businesses, I think this crisis is an incredible challenge for two reasons. One, obviously, is that particularly if you're closer to retail, your revenue dries up. But then in terms of borrowing and having access to the capital markets, if you're a small company, it's just harder, right? It's harder for you to get access to the bond market, for example, than if you're a large company. So my sympathy is completely with small businesses because I think they're in an incredibly difficult position right now. So rather than giving advice to the businesses themselves, I would give advice to government. And the advice to government is to remember just how important small business is in terms of employment creation and innovation, and therefore to create appropriate support programs, financial support programs, so that small businesses don't go bankrupt in the current environment. Because if they went bankrupt, it's not their responsibility, it's not their fault, it was just the virus. So I think active government intervention to support small business is exactly the right policy in the current environment.
How about advice for the future startup entrepreneurs, and how can they better prepare themselves for the market opportunities?
Well, actually, it's a great time to be an entrepreneur, I think, because you don't have to be selling things right now because there's not a lot to sell. What you can be doing is developing new ideas and new products, and you can probably borrow money at a reasonably low rate. So my advice to entrepreneurs would be to use this as an opportunity in essence, you know, there's a pause in the global economy. This is an opportunity to come up with new ideas and to be really well positioned for when that recovery begins, which we all hope will be later this year in 2020.
In which fields, industries that you think would be a good idea for them?
There are obvious things to say, right? Healthcare, anything in the healthcare world. But obviously, healthcare now gets much broader. So, for example, you know, something like food delivery, you would think of as an internet move. But today, food delivery looks like a health and safety move. So some combination of technology and things that will enable people to feel safer in their own personal environments, those are areas that I think are bound to blossom.
Last but not least, what would be your advice for young people preparing themselves for either new jobs or the future university applications?
Yeah, I, again, just as I think it's a great time to be an entrepreneur, I think it's a great time to be a student as well. And so, you know, I know that young Chinese people and their families understand that education is the ticket to future success. And I think that'll continue to be the case. So I just encourage people to study hard and to go to the best higher education institutions they can.
So just one last question to wrap up this wonderful and intelligent interview given by you. You can also take it as a philosophical question, that can we ever go back?
Yeah, I'm an optimist, but I'm a realistic optimist. So the optimist part of me says, yes, we will go back. You know, I love being in crowded cities like Beijing, for example. I want to be able to travel there. I want to be on the street in Beijing. I want to experience all of the life. But the realistic optimist in me says that it's not going to be exactly the same. You know, we've now learned that remote work, for example, it can be done. It's probably not as enjoyable, and I don't think we're as productive, but we can do it. Just think again about, do you go to a restaurant or do you get a delivery? We're going to move more in the delivery side. So a return to normal, but probably a new normal, and I just hope that happens sooner rather than later.